We're back, everyone, and I'm talking to author Mike Pirtle, here, a local person who's written two books of a trilogy, and we're going to get back to talking about the Judas Syndrome and rebirth. Now, Joel, when we were corresponding by email to set up this radio interview, I was asking if you do research with the library, and you said that there's some of that, but you also do personal experience. Can you tell listeners a little bit about the writing process with research in mind and where you're getting ideas?
Yeah, for sure. Writing itself is very organic. I have the big picture of a book. I have a beginning and an ending. A lot of the middle parts, for me, tend to write themselves as the characters develop and so on. And that's always a fun trip to make. But something like a post-apocalyptic series where you do need to have some information about what that apocalypse would do to the planet, how long it would last, things like that. That's definitely research. And yes, the library is a great resource. Personal experiences, well, I was a teenager once.
What? Okay, yeah. Really? Yeah.
Yeah. And I lived the world that they do live in the book, where they live, for example, where they end up is a real place.
You don't name the places.
No.
But they're recognizable to you.
They're very recognizable to me, okay. Yep. Maybe somebody who's lived in the area could even find them.
Oh,
they
really?
Could if they knew where they were.
There's a challenge.
Yeah, that's a challenge. That's a challenge for everybody. Personal experiences absolutely are a big part of it. Relationships, things like that. Like the
That's
relationship
right.
between Joel and Sarah absolutely is pulled from real.
That's where you get the background for your emotions that come out in
exactly.
this book.
Exactly. And I mean, a writer needs to experience as much as they can so that they can write about it. That's what I believe.
That's right.
Then the story becomes more real and people can experience maybe emotions or situations they've never experienced before.
Right.
In a real way.
Actually, readers are looking for that. I can tell when they're taking out books of the library, when they really like a book, they've been moved somehow. You know, maybe it was an exciting thriller, maybe it was something really funny, maybe it was something very sad. I used to think when advice to writers was, write what you know, I used to think that was, okay, well, I know, I used to work in a donut shop, I know what a donut shop looks like, I know what a library is. And it isn't those things at all. It's exactly what you're saying. What you know is the emotions of this sort of situation, and you can apply it to your writing. I think that comes out, that's interesting, in the second book, Rebirth, with Sarah, because, of course, she started off with her child right off the bat. That's a whole different story, again, to research.
Right, and, you know, the great thing about that is that it came at the right time. My wife and I just had a baby a year and a half ago, so as it was happening, I was writing the book, and it was perfect timing in that sense.
Perfect timing.
Yeah, yeah.
Would you like to read something from Rebirth?
Sure.
Great. And this book will be coming to the library.
Just to set this up, Sarah, who is the main character in Rebirth, and her baby have found themselves in an abandoned roadside carnival. And having shot dead two of the three occupants, what were the resident strongman and midget, she is left with the ringmaster to contend with. Welcome to carnival, the loudspeaker proclaimed again. I jumped at the voice. You have bested the strongman and sidekick. He continued. I felt a heat rise across my neck and cheeks and temples. Allow me to introduce myself. I am the ringmaster. You've guessed by now that all the animals are gone, consumed many months ago. The clowns were next, and then the buskers, and so on. It was the freaks that survived, under my guidance, and now, to be bested by a little girl with a gun. Shame on us. This guy was long gone a long time ago. The patients were running the asylum, so to speak. I pictured him surrounded by human remains, somewhere in a little room that overlooked the fairground. I set down my bag and was deliberating on what to do next when the speaker crackled on again. I would very much like to meet you. It was an invitation to dinner, no doubt, where Leif and I would be the main course. I will be down momentarily. Then the speakers went dead. Again, silence. I had to act or take cover. I panicked a moment, unsure of how to face this enemy. He was clearly nuts. He had probably been so since the moment he swallowed human flesh for the first time. I wondered which direction he might be coming from. It was impossible to tell. The speakers carried throughout the park. I looked toward the front gates. No one. Then I looked toward the back of the park, where an amphitheater, five stories tall, acted as the focal point. Rows of seating overlooked a central dirt pad where, I guessed, the ringmaster ran his circus. Suddenly, a violent breeze had picked up the dirt, swirling it in the air. The roar of an engine echoed off the seating, an amphitheater magnifying the sound. It was deafening. If his intention was to scare the living shit out of me, mission accomplished. It sounded like he was riding some hellish creation with 7 mufflers, 8 wheels, and an open engine. I was stuck in place, my nails digging into the wooden wall. I couldn't take my eyes off the spectacle. He tore down the grounds toward me, running over the corpses, crashing through the dilapidated food stations and game tents. I pulled myself away from the vision, backing off into the funhouse. I thought about hiding underground once more, but the idea of being trapped there with no escape plan, save shooting my way out, frightened me just as much as facing him head-on. The vehicle rushed past me, spewing dust onto the veranda. It was obnoxiously loud. He began circling the funhouse entrance in quick successive right turns. On closer inspection of the vehicle, I could see it was some kind of motorcycle with 2 massive wheels in the back and 1 in the front, connected to the bike by a long chrome leg. The man's appearance was blurred by the amount of dust and dirt he was kicking up, likely a tactic he was using to flush me out. Instead, I decided to take aim.
Oh, that's one of the creepy ones.
Yeah, that was a fun one to write, actually, yeah.
You enjoyed writing that one?
A carnival, yeah.
There's something about carnivals, aren't they? That we're all attracted to them, the bright lights when we're kids, and then you get older and there's just a creepiness.
Yeah, there's a creepy, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So you purposely set that in the carnival?
Mm-hmm, yeah. I thought it was a good experience for Sarah to go through and, yeah.
Yeah. Actually, the second book, Rebirth, I did find that it was more setting up for what's to come, I think. And maybe off the radio, you'll tell me all the secrets. No. But there is still a lot of action. It moves. And I think I find this about your writing is sometimes I want the bigger picture. I'm thinking, what does it look like out there? Where are we in the world? And then I come right back to the action. It moves very quickly from scene to scene to scene. You've kept that up for 2 books.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to do that in the third?
I am, yeah. I like a book that moves. I like to give you some idea of where you are, but I do want you to kind of paint the picture too. I think it's a nice idea to let the audience make the picture out of maybe a limited description. Mm-hmm. Writing in first person, it lets you sort of take ownership of the book you're reading.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, with the Judas Syndrome, the story really was all about Joel.
Mm.
The Rebirth, although Sarah's a narrator, it's really all about her son.
That's right.
Can you talk a little bit more about the son and the angel, actually?
Sure.
Those two.
Absolutely. Leif, the son, he is essentially the heir to Joel's forsaken destiny. And in that respect, Leif is one of the main characters in the book. And though it's told by Sarah, who is certainly the main character, it sets up the third book for Leif to become the main character.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
As for the angel or spirit, someone that is a recurring character from Rebirth who helps or at least attempts to guide Joel in the right direction, this character, he was fun to write, the all-knowing, all-seeing entity that guides the major characters in each book, actually. He guides Sarah sort of at a distance, whereas with Joel, he really took...
He was up close and personal.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. And so though he took a direct approach with Joel in guiding him towards a destiny. The idea, I guess, the destiny and the human resolve to make our own choices offers a dichotomy to the storyline and gives the reader something to contemplate.
Oh, definitely.
And the angel offers a clear path, but resistance to a predetermined life builds tension throughout the trilogy as the main characters struggle to either accept or forsake the Blank Man's guidance. Now, Blank Man is the name that Leif gives the angel in the second book as he grows up. And they become great friends in the third, I can tell you.
But if I'm not mistaken, that's also a tie back to the first novel.
Absolutely. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So that's a nice through line. Actually, that gives 2 lines for readers, I think, to go through these books. One is, what would you do in the world, the concrete world that we live in, should this kind of apocalyptic thing happen? And then there's the spiritual side inside, the question, you know, what does that do for you? For that individual, the scene you just read of Rebirth, I don't know, do I have it in me to shoot a gun and kill somebody? But, you know, if I get a baby strapped to me, that's a different story.
Yeah.
So it really makes people think differently about how would I be in that way? How would I keep my own morals in that kind of environment? We're coming up near the end, and I always like to end with a reading. So I'm going to give you the heads up that I'm going to ask for another reading. But I'd also like to know, can you tell us a little bit about the process you went through with it? Because you didn't publish through the mainstream. You've self-published.
Right. I actually live in that social networking world, my day-to-day, and for that reason, I was able to come up with a lot of ways to self-publish and actually successfully sell books and ebooks through online options. For me, self-publishing has been the right choice, but as I mentioned to you earlier off radio, with the third book coming to a conclusion and hopefully end of this year, I'm hoping to make an anthology and take my reviews and my fans to a publisher and see if it's something that they might be interested in.
Yeah. Yes, individually they're short books, so they read quickly. So it's a great summertime read. Take it to the cottage,
right.
You'll get hooked, and the next day you, when you haven't slept all night because you couldn't wait till the next scene, they would pull together as one nice novel, one nice volume, I should say.
Mm.
Okay. Well, I just wanted to thank you, Mike, for coming this distance, because I know you traveled a little bit to come back home and read this for the listeners of Whistle Radio. And you're going to finish off with which book?
I'll read from The Judas Syndrome, the first book of the series.
Okay.
Just to set it up, seniors in high school and just a week away from graduation, Joel and 13 of his closest friends take a camping trip to a lake 2 hours north of their small town. As with any unsupervised camping trip, alcohol and drugs are as much a part of the scenery as are trees and water. So in this scene, Earl, the history buff of the group and skilled hunter, explains the imminent destruction of mankind. As dusk set in, conversation around the fire progressed from mellow dinner talk to a confrontation between Earl and Caroline over world issues. Caroline disagreed with him on the necessity of war as the great leveler. Practically every time we had a weekend away, Earl got into a debate with someone on this subject. "Earl," I said, "we're not on this again, are we?" He smirked, took a sip from his pint, and kept up the discussion with Carolyn. "Do you think this will lead into his infamous end-of-the-world speech?" I asked Connor. "Is the Pope Catholic?" It didn't take Earl long to find the opening he'd been waiting for. I heard Carolyn say, "You actually believe we need world wars, famine, and disease? You think we need these things, things that extinguish the human race? Do you really think that with all the pollution we pump into the atmosphere and the theft of the planet's natural resources, it wouldn't fight back to rid itself of this disease that's killing it, like a surgeon cutting out the cancer?" John attempted to speak, but Earl raised his hand and continued, "With all the new diseases popping up, earthquakes, forest fires, and tornadoes, you have to see that the world is actually fighting back. It's karma. There are too many people on the planet with no respect for what it can do for us, what it is doing for us. Nature's a bitch. 300 million killed off in the 20th century from smallpox alone. The Spanish flu wiped out nearly 100 million during the Great War. The Black Death, 75 million over the course of 300 years. He paused again, hands still up. His index and forefinger started to wiggle. "Jake, set me up with a butt." Jake threw a cigarette to him without missing a beat. Earl lit it and continued. "And we're not much better. Nearly 60 million people killed during the Second World War. Horrible statistics. But necessary? You bet. With fewer people to shelter and feed, the planet isn't hit as hard by mankind's abuses. Right now, there are too many people on Earth, so you can expect to see one of two things happening soon, war or global retaliation. Read Malthus, man. It's all there in black and white. My money's on war. Look at the history of the world. Did you know that in all of recorded history, there have been only 7 days of peace? And that's seven in total, combined, taking an hour here, a few minutes there. War has been controlling population ever since we learned to fight."
You've been listening to Shelf Life, news from the Whitchurch-Stouffville Public Library. For more information about library programs and services, check out our website at www.whitchurch-library.on.ca. Or you can call the library at 905-642-7323 or toll free at 1-888-603-4292. Or why not visit the library in person at 30 Burkholder Street in Stouffville? Thank you for listening.